social media are taking the world from the read-only culture of the 20th century to the read-write culture that we're now in and which is changing very rapidly. That's from Lawrence Lessig. The read-write culture of social media is about every person essentially being encouraged to be an independent author and producer. The other big change in social media that we've seen recently has involved a movement from what Jay Rosen called life-sharing to mind-sharing, which has had a tremendous political impact, for example, in the Middle East. And the impact of this transformation on organizational information governance and cyber risk has not been adequately addressed, though. And we're seeing it on a daily basis in the issues expressed by our clients. The main impact, I think, is to broaden the notion that most of my friends in the cyber risk world have about the bad guys. Yes, it's true that the black market in trading in personal information and company information has been growing steadily. The Verizon studies and other studies show that malware and hacking have become dominant, and we see it every day in sophisticated new approaches. But at the same time, there's a new ethos of transparency, whistleblowing, and increasing availability of electronic drop boxes. In this world, if you're perceived to be a bad company, thousands of people around the world are mobilized. They take down your website and do other things to you. In a down economy, also, angry employees and former employees will eagerly use an anonymous electronic drop box. Not for money, but for transparency. Organizational information governance and management strategies need to address both the bad guys that most security and cyber risk people understand and this new group of people who represent threats in a sense, but in many cases are the company's own employees, the company's customers. So listening to those employees and customers in this context is critical, and it doesn't mean the same thing as the listening that a company like Toyota is famous for doing on the shop floor. You're familiar with WikiLeaks and the approach of WikiLeaks to use the internet and cryptography to lower the risks of whistleblowing. You may be familiar with OpenLeaks. OpenLeaks has gotten started in 2011, and it's basically, as it describes itself, a project that aims to make whistleblowing safer and more widespread. So it's being done by providing dedicated and free services to whistleblowers and training programs to whistleblowers and a knowledge base. What are the implications for organizations that leaks are made in good faith? There's a tendency for both political figures and traditional media to characterize whistleblowers as traitors or criminals, call for the death penalty, and so on and so forth. But what is necessary for organizations, insofar as many of these issues arise with employees or former employees or customers, is to engage in dialogue of various sorts, including training in the importance of information governance and privacy and information security and trade secret protections with employees, including strong, credible commitments by employees to protect information, and including listening through whistleblower and other programs. Now, I'm going to give you a contrasting case. The contrasting case illustrates both a technical loss and a cultural loss. Because it's based on two basic errors. A group of security companies teamed up to beat WikiLeaks and Anonymous, and the ringleader of this group boasted about the ability to do it. What happened was Anonymous essentially leaked a tremendous amount of email and some telling PowerPoints about their strategy. And these... I'm going to quote from a few of these PowerPoints because it gives you an insight into the mistakes that are being made in fighting these bad guys, so-called. First of all, the tactics, included feeding the fuel between the feuding groups, disinformation, creating messages around actions to sabotage or discredit the opposing organization, submitting fake documents and calling out the error, cyber attacks against that involve falsification, a variety of other tactics. The fact of the matter is there's an assumption that you can win technologically, and generally that assumption is probably false for any organization when you're dealing with a crowdsourced opponent. There was also an assumption that you could influence people in the media, specifically, in this case, Glenn Greenwald, who became a major media opponent of these groups. That was based on a misunderstanding of the whole ethos of the opponents in this case. To quote from one of the PowerPoint slides, these are established professionals that have a liberal bent, but ultimately most of them, if pushed, will choose professional preservation over cost. Such is the mentality of most business professionals. What you see there is an interesting failure of the attempt to essentially beat the bad guys, which is illustrative for any organization. Now let's look at what leaks have become. Leaks is really the wrong word. What you really see is big data, giant databases that are being essentially shared. And big data is a term that is being used more and more in the information technology world to denote the kind of analysis that is done on huge databases too large for manual analysis. At this point, WikiLeaks is in its infancy, and OpenLeaks, in the sense that people are just going through this data without these tools, these big data analytic tools. But as leaks continue to become giant piles of data that are essentially made public, using the electronic Dropboxes that have virtually unlimited capacity, there's a real need for mediation, and there's a need, and that may in fact become what the press does to a certain extent, is sophisticated analytics on giant masses of data that are leaked. At this point, it's a more slow and manual process. The future of security in this environment involves community-based malware and other kinds of detection. But really what's happened to date is the focus is entirely on criminalization. And so that has prevented a focus on good practices, on managing risk, and the kinds of things that we will need to get into as the cyber risk world begins to deal more and more with these kinds of situations. For example, it's often alleged that there is unintended harm, collateral damage from breach of giant masses of sensitive information. People are being outed who are spies, for example. That's a potential role for a trusted third party and also for sophisticated data analytics, as I mentioned before. And whistleblowers going forward will have many choices of ways of dropping information. So there are roles for best practices in this area. There's talk of things like a Geneva Convention for cyber war. So key steps: organizations need to create awareness at the board and senior management level about the risks of losses of information through electronic Dropboxes and the like. What this awareness does is it really creates a focus on the value of digital assets, which is very useful in the context of building the case for cyber risk insurance and the type of insurance. We've been focused in the cyber risk world, and I'm focused in my day-to-day practice, on personal information. Personal information is just a tiny bit of the organization's information stores. The analytic power of big data and the potential for tremendous leaks of big data will drive a new focus on information governance and the management of digital assets. And along with this, as I said, we need to focus on employee communications, training and whistleblower programs, customer communications, in order to be able to try to achieve positive outcomes in these very difficult situations.